Hi again, people. It's thundering outside. I'm watching this trial a little bit of Karen Reed, to where she's saying the cops set her up, and she didn't do it, and she's got a lot of support. And I'm kind of interviewing some of these witnesses, so I decided to start copying and leaving this running so I could comment on how witnesses are doing and what they're saying, and when I see something odd or etc. So if you want to go watch trial, you're more than welcome to. I'm just going to give my insight a little bit on this witness right here. He's a council member. His brother was a cop. He's friends with the chief. The chief donated to him, and they interviewed him the night this guy, this Boston cop, was killed. And there was some interesting things in here. So I'm running this at speed of 1.5, so it's going to seem like they're fast because I'm trying to get through this. But this is the defense questioning this witness that the prosecution is using, and I'm not sure how they used it because I didn't listen to the first part where he got interviewed. But you can tell that the defense is trying to paint a picture with this guy that there's connections, he has influence, and if there was wrongdoing, or in my experience, could be totally wrong. When a defense starts yelling corruption, look over there, don't look at my client, it's usually a game. This woman has a lot of support. That's another thing that I'm kind of like. The people supporting her do not have all the facts. The trial is going on, and they're already supporting her, saying she's innocent, and they haven't even heard a trial yet. So the one video I did see is she was running around, as Karen Reed was running around when he was dead, saying, "I did this. It's my fault. I did this." That is extremely hard to overcome by trying to say the cops set all this up, they beat him up, etc. So to me, my initial gut instinct on his trial, and a lot of people have been sending it to me, my initial gut instinct is, this is a game, she's probably responsible, I don't think she's going to take the stand. If she takes the stand, my opinion will change. I don't think she'll take the stand. I know she doesn't have a right, but most innocent people will be like, I don't care, I'm telling the jury I didn't do it. So we'll see how it goes. But you can, in this guy's interview, you can tell that the defense is kind of cornering him, and the prosecution's objecting a lot, and there's a lot of sidebars.
Correct.
And you were familiar with him, correct?
And what do you mean? What do you mean familiar?
You knew who he was. You know, you became familiar with him.
Yeah, he was my neighbor. I knew who he was.
So this guy, I don't know if he's got some cop background or not, but he's pretty good about appearing confused, like he doesn't need the answer. He doesn't use the right terminology. He tells the attorney to rephrase it when I think he means, can you repeat that? Or I don't understand that. And he says, can you rephrase that? That's, the judge might tell you to rephrase something. The prosecution may object and they don't like the way it's implied. So the judge will say, re-ask the question, rephrase it, or re-ask the question a different way. But he keeps telling the defense attorney, can you rephrase that? Which is, I don't know if the jury sees it, but I see it as he's what they call a hostile witness. He's not a friendly witness. He's definitely trying to push back against the defense. And in my case, when defense kind of attacked me, it was kind of like, you're doing your job, whatever. I mean, you know, do what you got to do.
And you knew that he was not married, correct?
Yes.
And at a certain point, you knew that he was dating Karen Reed.
Yeah, at some point.
Now, you would agree with me that...
The fact that this guy shows up and he's one of the five council members of his town, that he shows up without a tie or a sports jacket to court, kind of iffy for me. I would think he'd... I mean, I don't mind that he didn't have a tie, but at least a sports coat. But maybe the courts there are real casual. I don't know. As a cop, we always had to have a suit and tie in plain clothes or our uniform of the day. So if we were working, I'd go in there like some freaking SWAT dude with my boots bloused and a big shirt that says police and my web belt on with blue jeans, because that's what we worked in. And that's because I was working. But if we were off duty, we went in either in our official police uniform or a suit and tie. So when I see people testifying in court without a suit and tie, especially if they're in the government, I'm always kind of like,
As a police background, sir, correct?
I wouldn't agree with that statement.
Two of your brothers are or were police officers, correct?
Out of seven of us, yes.
And you knew friends of your brother's who were also police officers or in law enforcement, correct?
Correct.
And you would already testify that you know
something. So a lot of his questions, because I've watched this and I rolled back so I could go over it. A lot of his answers are kind of like, I don't know what you mean. Can you rephrase that? And then when he's drilled by the defense in certain things that basically says what he could have answered yes, he answers yes to everything. To me, that's, it's not argumentative, but it's, he's not being friendly. He's not being upfront. He's trying to make the lawyer pull the truth out, which always makes me question a witness. Do I think he was involved in a setup because of this? No. But it does make me question his credibility as a witness.
Some members of the Canton Police Department, correct?
Correct.
And you socialized with police officers, did you not?
Have I? Sure.
You've been to bars with police officers, correct?
Correct.
And you drank with police.
Did you see that? Did you see he said correct with the word and his nonverbal was no? So he's thinking too hard for these answers for me. This guy doesn't have a lot of credibility with me. Watch his answer versus his head movement.
Sure.
You've been to bars with police officers, correct?
Correct.
And you drank with police officers, right?
Sure.
And you were friendly with police officers, correct?
Yes.
Notice the head tilt, yes, on these, but the other one was like, correct.
And with regard to...
Notice the licking of the lips? He's nervous. He's in a hot seat. His body position is tense and not relaxed, like, hey, bring it on. What do you got to ask me? I'm just here to tell the truth. I don't give a shit. I'm not trying to blow my own horn. A lot of juries always came back with feedback for me and said I was always believable and I seem like an honest, good cop or whatever the terminology I use. I always got positive feedback from juries when the DAs after a jury trial will go to the jury and go, is there anything I could have done better in this trial? Was there anything or any witness that you thought wasn't honest or trustworthy or somebody that you really thought was honest or trustworthy? And I had several DAs come to me and go, hey, man, the jury liked you. And I'm like, all right, whatever. I mean, I never tried to impress the jury. I just am who I am. And, if you're telling the truth, you really don't have to think a whole bunch.
I'd like to ask you some questions about people specifically connected to this case. We've established that Lieutenant Lank has been a friend of yours for years, correct?
Yes.
We've established that you know former police chief Kenneth Berkowitz in such a way that you feel comfortable calling him before this jury Kenny Berkowitz, correct?
I know Kenny, yep.
Notice he didn't answer? Notice he said you feel comfortable. Why couldn't he just say, yeah, I feel comfortable calling Kenny? Why couldn't he say that? He had to think about it, and then he didn't answer the question. He said, yeah, I know Kenny. These are little things that I don't know if everybody catches, and I'm not trying to say I'm super smart and I catch all this shit. Just being around it so much and interviewing so many people and picking up when people are lying and trying to get confessions out of people in an interview room and then watching them testify, these things just pop up naturally, man. It's just a big red flag. It's kind of like if you're a nurse and you watch a TV show about nursing, you're like, that's bullshit. I watch shows about horses and I know horses and it's kind of like, that's bullshit. That's wrong. So it just sticks out. When people testify and things don't add up, it sticks out to me.
Calling him before this jury, Kenny Berkowitz, correct?
I know Kenny, yep.
And he's actually donated to your campaign when you were running for town selectman, correct?
Correct.
And
scratching the neck. Anytime the hands are around a face, they're trying to avoid speak no evil, hear no evil, and see no evil. Our natural instinct is to move our hands in our area if we either don't, we want to hold back because we're lying, or we think the person asking us is full of shit and we're trying to hold back from saying screw you or whatever. The closer the mouth, the more the resistive, the more the things. He's very...
You also knew Michael Proctor prior to January 29th of 2022, correct?
Correct.
You've attended social events together with him, have you not?
Objection.
I'll let out one question.
Couple.
So.
Do you see the head? A couple. That was an affirmative answer with a negative nonverbal.
You've attended social events together with him, have you not?
Objection.
I'll let out one question.
Couple.
A couple. So that could mean he didn't like it. It could mean a few things.
At some point, Michael Proctor came to question you, did he not?
Along with another trooper, correct.
And at the point in time when Michael Proctor...
Did he come to you? He should have just said, yeah, he came to me. He didn't. With another officer. This is where you have a witness that loses credibility because they're trying to defend their position or they're trying to fight back what the lawyer is trying to paint instead of just being honest. Why did he have to say with another trooper? Did he come visit you? Yes.
Did he not?
Along with another trooper, correct.
And at the point in time when Michael Proctor came to question you, you knew who he was, correct?
Yes.
You knew him by face, correct?
Correct.
And you knew him by name, correct?
Correct.
There was no need for Michael Proctor to formally introduce himself to you, was there?
Objection.
What did he say?
The fact that this witness is holding back on the objections tells me he's experienced in this role. Most people that are asked a question, they will answer immediately. New cops that haven't testified a lot, they'll answer immediately and they won't wait for the attorney to object. So when an attorney objects, you always want to wait for the objection, wait a couple seconds, because he may not want to get that answer in, or he thinks he's going down a path that will open a door that he doesn't want to open. And you need to wait for the objection and then find out if the judge rules yes or no, and then you answer the question. If it's ruled, overruled. If it's sustained, then you don't have to answer it. He waits for all the objections, which goes to his experience in testifying in my book.
When he first walked in the door, in terms of introductions.
Objection.
Sustained.
May we be seen aside, partner?
Sure.
For Michael Proctor to formally introduce himself to you for that meeting, correct?
Yes.
He didn't need to say, how do you do, I am Michael Proctor, correct?
No.
No. Do you consider the Proctors to be the Albert second family?
Objection.
Do you consider that?
No.
You are aware that there are members of the Proctors family who have posted publicly that the
objection,
Albert is second family, correct?
So the objection is sustained, and I'm striking that question.
Disregard. Now, at the time that Trooper Michael Proctor showed up to question you, sir, you knew that Karen Reed had been charged in this case, correct?
Yes.
And you knew that John O'Keefe had been found dead on your brother's lawn, correct?
Correct.
Did it occur to you that it was odd that the state police sent somebody from the Proctor family to interview you?
Objection, Your Honor.
Now, I'm not sure if he's objecting. I'm assuming there's some sort of previous agreement that he wasn't allowed to ask or bring up certain things without clearing it first or without showing he could tie it, or he had some corroborating on why he was asking this and he would tie it together. So these objections are the prosecution doesn't want to hear it. As a jury member, when the government is trying to keep me as a juror from hearing information, it's never good. I always grow suspicion. Now, I'm not saying this girl's innocent, and I'm not saying she's guilty. My initial take, I already told you, most people that don't kill people don't run around the dead body going, oh my God, I killed him, it's my fault. That's just not normal. I mean, I've been around a lot of dead bodies, I never said that. But anyway, it just, in this case, oh, I was talking about jurors. So when jurors, as a juror, if you're hearing the prosecution object, I want that stricken. Your Honor, we already talked about that in chambers. He's not allowed to bring that up. When I hear all that, those are all big red flags. The government has such a weak case that they have to hide shit. In my mind, if your case is strong, let it out, baby. Everyone can see it for what it is. But if your case is weak and you're not 100% sure, you want to hide information, and I don't like that. So this type of objections from the prosecution and this type of wiggle room from this witness on answering the questions would all be pushing me to, there ain't no way I'm giving the government a guilty verdict on this. I don't care if I think she did it or not. Anyway, I'm at 15 minutes. I'm going to look through here. I may make a couple more of these, but we'll see how it goes. All right, this is the Karen Reed trial, day 8.